Hope everybody had a chance to refill the coffee, get a snack out there, and thank Nautel for sponsoring our morning break. Our next guest started out in engineering, working for several successful radio stations like WMMS, WHK in Cleveland, rebuilt Z100 in New York City, which he designed in 1983, started Omnia Audio, which has been a leader and a trendsetter for audio processing. Omnia Audio is now part of the Telos Alliance based in Cleveland, where they remain a leading signal processing company. He leads a talented team that researches, designs, and develops innovative and disruptive technology for every form of broadcasting, AM, FM, and HD radio. If you would, give a nice warm welcome to Mr. Frank Foti.
I think the key word there was warm, you know. All right. First of all, it's always an honor to be able to attend something that's in your home state, you know, with fellow broadcasters, not only from Ohio, Indiana, Kentucky, and I even saw earlier today we've got somebody down here from Canada, which is kind of cool. So we'll get right at it. I was telling Scott that today's topic, it's almost like you're going to get like a two for Tuesday, because we're going to talk about what's on the agenda, and then I've got something on the back end that deals with some work that I've been doing, has to do with multipath and the study of multipath, and I figured I'd share it with all of you guys, and we'll use it as a warm-up, because I pitched this as a as an abstract to the NAB for next spring. So I'll start out with this slide here, because one of the things that I think, if I may say so, that I think has been a core foundation of our company, and a lot of it was with our late founder, Steve Church, and myself, is be curious. You know, a quick story I love to tell, because it's a true story, about Steve Church, and that is before Steve introduced the Telos 10 telephone hybrid, he read a paper that had been written by the guys at Bell Labs, scientists at Bell Labs, decades earlier, and it was all about trans-hybrid loss. And these engineers at Bell Labs had been studying trans-hybrid loss as a way to improve the two-wire to four-wire conversion on long-distance telephone lines. And they thought about trying to come up with some adaptive hybrid that would make long-distance phone calls sound better. Well, after years, and I mean years of development, they couldn't make it work. So their last task was they had to write a paper on why it didn't work. And in this paper, they wrote the following: based on all this study, research, development, we've determined that an adaptive trans hybrid can never, ever be accomplished. Well, I hear people laughing, because fast forward to 1985, there was a young kid who at the time was working not too far from here in Indianapolis at WFBQ, and Steve Church came up with the first adaptive hybrid, and he changed. Literally changed probably talk shows because of the performance of that hybrid. I see some people shaking their heads out there, because you probably all had, you know, an early Telos product. And I was one of the first to, I put one on Z100 in New York. And I'll make it quick, because I know I got to get to the topic here. But I put the thing on, and two things happened. One, I had probably Babe Ruth of morning shows, Scott Shannon, and Scott, you know, if the phone rang in the morning, you knew you're in trouble. And the phone rings one morning, and I said, and it's Scott. He's like, "Franco, you're killing me, man." And this is the morning after we get the thing on the air. I said, "Scott, how's the phone sound?" "Franco," excuse my language, "the phone sounds effing fantastic." "What's the matter?" "You took away my ka-chunk, ka-chunk, ka-chunk." Because you know what I'm talking about? When you would switch on a 1A2, you got the DC hit, and we'd go, chunk. That was Scott's psychological cue that the next call was on the air. So I figured, if that's his only complaint, Steve, you done good, you know? So, and then the second was, day later, there was a guy that was the director of engineering for when NBC used to have a news department, NBC Radio News. His name was Warren Vandeveer. And Warren was a closet Z100 fan. Because remember, he said NBC should be listening to IMUS, right? So I get this phone call, and it's like, Frank Warren's on the phone from NBC. Put him on. Foti, Vandeveer, what's up? What'd you effing do to the phone? Now I'm thinking something's wrong. He goes, the damn callers sound like they're right in my headphones as I'm on the subway on the way to 30 Rock. Warren's real easy. Dial this number. At this time, Steve's chief engineer at MMS in Cleveland. And just tell him Frank told you to call. Okay. An hour later, the phone rings. It's Steve. Frank. What, Steve? What'd you tell NBC? I told him to call you. Frank, I only made 10 of those damn things. You got the last one. Well, what's the problem? They want 55. Steve, I have a soldering iron. So stay curious, my friends. All right. We live in a connected world, but you don't need me to tell you that, right? So what we want to talk about is one of the things that way back when Steve and myself and Greg Shea and our folks began the process of what's now AES 67 or audio over IP, we back then were thinking about it as an ecosystem within our industry. And that's what we're going to talk about today. And we are seeing increased flexibility, more so than what we just thought we could. Oh, hey, we can get mono audio from here or halfway around the world, or 5.1, you know, surround, or now immersive audio all over the world using the network. We've now seen it where it's available for mono, stereo, surround, immersive, SDI, and what we're going to talk about today, we can now use our network capability to get the FM composite signal around. This is a short refresher. Anyone who's in this room has been around an FM radio station, you know what I'm talking about. We don't need to delve into all the details on this, but what we are going to talk about and delve into, and I don't want to trip over this wire. I just learned last week I need to get a knee resurfacing. So on my way home, I'm going to stop at the train station and pick up a Dremel tool and do it on my way, you know. Don't get old. But in any case, what we're talking about actually, at least from our vision, is a natural progression utilizing the MPX signal as, you know, less than 10 years ago, about this time of year, myself and the guys from Canada, we were at the broadcaster's clinic and we're having some pasta and wine and we're like, hey, why can't we take the MPX signal and stick it over AES? You know, if we give you a port on the transmitter, can you, you know, a few more glasses of wine, and we came up with a way to do it. So this is the progression from there. And we can do this as a direct point-to-point connection, like a nailed-up connection, or we can do it point-to-multipoint. Point-to-multipoint has been very popular internationally for a very, very long time. You know, it's very common, let's say, in France to have what they call networks there are much different than what we would call a network. But you could have, you know, one of these network broadcasters like Energy where, you know, they'll deploy a signal out of Paris and then they may hit 200 little transmitters that cover the country of France. But in each location, they have to have a separate stereo generator into this and into that. Well, now we'd be able to, like, you know, have that network signal leave Paris and hit all those transmitters pretty much the same amount of time. And, you know that you've got the same signal integrity of what's leaving Paris can leave any of the transmitters. And we're now starting to see that here. You know, the whole concept of networked broadcasting or, you know, cloud-based broadcasting, this fits right into it. We could do this in a linear implementation to do it, and we're actually working on that part of the software now. It would take more than 2 megabits per second. But, you know, tip of the hat to some colleagues over in Holland, Hans von Sutphen and Matthias. They worked on this specialized codec, which we'll go into some detail on here in a little bit, that we refer to as micro MPX. And we're able to utilize this micro MPX. I'll make sure I'm keeping track of my time here, where instead of having to have a composite signal that's going to utilize more than 2 megabits per second, we're actually able to get the signal down to 320 kilobits per second. And you might be thinking, Frank Foti, about 10 years ago, weren't you the same Goomba up there telling us not to use a codec and audio processing and blah, blah, blah? Yes. And am I going to stand up here like a, you guys can throw knives now, like a Democrat or a Republican and say that I lied, you know, and you want to impeach me? By the way, well, I do have late in the presentation, I was able to get it in here. I have a, we do know, you will see that I will reveal the whistleblower later today. I will, I promise you. But in any case, on account of this new development of this codec that was designed by the guys over in the Netherlands, we're able to get the composite signal through a 320 kilobit pipe, precision peak control, no damage to the signal, and basically have a mere replication of what goes in is what comes out. So it's very efficient data payload. And to give you an idea, this here is if we did not do the codec, this gives an idea based on sample rate and bit depth what type of linear type of data rates we would need. Now, we know there are going to be some people that are going to want to do linear. And as I said, we do have a version of software that'll do the linear replication coming out very soon. But the cool thing is, you know, when you think about it, 20 years ago, we were all excited about being able to get stereo down 128 kilobit ISDN circuit. Now we're pumping FM composite with RDS down 320 kilobits per second. That's pretty incredible. And I got to tell you, I have spent hours listening back and forth to, you know, the composite output of the audio processor and then, you know, running it through a comparable delay because we're somewhere in the 20 millisecond delay throughput, and then switching AB, the composite, between the output of the micro MPX or the MPX node that, you know, we'll talk about here in a moment. And I got to tell you, you cannot hear you cannot hear a difference whatsoever. So this here now becomes a new tool, a new arsenal for the broadcaster in something that we did not have before. I'll quickly go over this because I did touch on this. This was designed specifically, this codec, for FM transmission. Now, you may be out there saying, but wait a minute. Codecs, there's artifacts. The answer is yes, there are. There are artifacts with a codec. What these guys did was they found a way to, in typical codec fashion, of hiding the artifacts. And they do it in a manner that takes advantage of how noise gets introduced in the transmission path. And when you think about how FM happens, the noise in an FM signal goes up 6 dB per octave. So what they do is they actually hide the coding artifacts in that noise. So in the decoded side, you know, it comes out of the receiver, the ear, you know, it's that whole psychoacoustic phenomenon going on. The artifacts that are there do get eliminated. The other aspect is there are zero overshoots. And considering yours truly and some of my colleagues have butted heads in the same way that, and generally speaking, the same result is, and in my case, I refer to my competitor as like that team up north, you know? And we're the Ohio State Buckeyes. Need I say more? And you're talking about a guy who in a family has one brother who went to school a few blocks from here, and the other one went north of Toledo. That brother isn't loved. I love him 364 days a year. Who knows? But in any case, the overshoot issue, there are ways. There have been new developments, and we'll talk a little bit about that here today, in overshoot control, where we're able to do it, and it's not necessarily, oh, there's an overshoot, let's clip it, oh, and we'll find out, and we'll figure out a way to deal with the harmonics or whatever annoyances might come out a little later. There's been some new developments by moving all of this into the frequency domain as compared to the time domain, where it changes everything. And that type of technology is employed here. Therefore, we're able to provide a peak-controlled output where there's zero overshoots at all. It supports double sideband and single sideband, supports RDS, and it does support pilot embedding, which is a unique little trick that'll give you 1 dB more in loudness. And we have that demo here for you today. So, as I say, it's even more than a two for Tuesday. Or maybe it should be a two for Thursday, right? You know, all day yesterday I thought it was Monday. So, you know, like I said, 63 years, if you look in this year, it's, you know, light on the other side, right? So, all right. I think I touched on this. We're using what we call spectral domain processing. And this is something that I remember years ago, Steve Church saying to me, you know, if you could get your mind out of the X and Y plane and go into the Z plane and learn how to deal with things in the spectrum as compared to the time domain, there's a lot of things you could probably achieve. Well, Steve, if you're listening, you know, it took the bullheaded Sicilian, but we did figure it out. And we've actually, aside from the stuff in the micro MPX work or the MPX node, some of our new developments coming in audio processing takes advantage of this. Again, we're able to raise that bar just ever so much to where the end result is delivering to you or your listeners cleaner audio for the same level of competitive loudness. So it's not your grandfather's algorithm, and that's what I'll say. I'm going to go over some block diagrams, and then we're going to get into some other fun stuff here. This here's, you know, some of this you may have seen. The difference, do we have a pointer? Or, well, in any case, you can see down here in the corner here, you can see there's an audio processor and something called MPX node. So basically now we've got the ecosystem, and out of that MPX node would be composite. And here's another way where you could have one node talking to another node, one obviously at a main control point or a studio point, the other one out at the transmission point. And then this gives a couple of examples of like real world scenarios as to how it can be. And by the way, one of the things that could also happen is that the decoder, the software that's running in the decoder, eventually you'll probably see it just be in the transmitter. So at some point you probably just have an RJ45 connecting right into the transmitter, and that will replace the BNC going into the exciter. And so, you know, networked MPX going right into your modulator. And, you know, there's a lot. I mean, we're just scratching the surface, guys, on this now. This is an example we can do today. This is one of the products that we have where we can embed the micro MPX technology right into the audio processor. And at some point, you might even see, you know, where it's going into your into the cloud, if you will, and then that may even eventually be connecting right into the transmitter. Here's an example of what we would call the point to multipoint scenario I was talking about a bit earlier. It will work with radios, you know, meaning STL. It'll work in a satellite. I think we've got somebody. I forget that. I thought maybe we had somebody in Europe doing this for the satellite, but I think I'm getting ahead of myself. Here's basically using another configuration where, you know, basically you can put any audio processor, and going into an MPX node is you have analog composite going in, and then, you know, the same if you're using the node on the backside out at the transmitter. Now, think about this. 5 FM stereo radio stations running, utilizing less than 2 megabits per second. You know, so, you know, you've got a lot of flexibility, cost efficiency, and, you know, just taking the next step forward, if you will. Just a little peek. You take a look at, like, most of our stuff with a node. You hit it with a web page. This gives you some information as to how the data is behaving, get a look at the peak control, and also get a spectral view of the composite signal. Now, the next slide, when it comes on, is going to have audio. And I want to explain it before I put it up, because the audio is going to start the moment it plays. It's going to show how the one how 1 dB pilot embedding works. As you look here and you think of the FM stereo system, theoretically, FM stereo works where 100% modulation is theoretically 90% audio, 10% pilot, right? Well, we're gonna screw up the math, because when you embed the pilot, you're basically allowing the audio to go to 100% at all times. And rather than adding the pilot, we embed the pilot. We take advantage of the pilot interleaving function so that the pilot, it's still there at 10%, it's not being clipped, it's not being modulated, but it's there at all times. So the next video that's going to come up, it's going to be a song playing, and you're going to see the modulation hitting 100%. You're going to see the pilot slowly go away, and theoretically, the peak level should drop to 90%, right? It doesn't. It stays at 100%. And then when the pilot comes back in, it stays at 100%. So if we're able to take that 10% and give it to audio, that's 1 dB more in loudness. It's theoretically, if you want 110% modulation to get that extra dB. Now, I can guarantee you that not one guy in this room has ever done 110% modulation. When I worked in New York, real quick, people used to say, well, Z100 was the loudest on the dial because you overmodulated. I said, no, we didn't. I said, yes, you did. I said, we are no more modulated than the competition. What's their modulation? 125. We are no more modulated than they were. So, you know, what are you going to do? You know, somebody used to say to me, why do you do that? I'd say, well, if the kid guy down the street goes going to the corner store and getting a free pop and not paying for it, I want my free pop. So I got my free pop. Now, what are you going to do? Okay, so the next thing, this will illustrate how the pilot embedding works. You can see the pilot's there, 100%. And you see the mod there, it's 100, say 100. Now, the pilot's going away. Mod should be at 90. It's still at 100. The pilot's going to come back here in a moment. Okay, Pete, Roger, thank you. I'm sharing this because all of this tech works with the micro MPX. And think about it. This is a technology that gives your listeners one added dB in perceived loudness without changing the processing. Now, you might be thinking, well, wait a minute, 1 dB, I can't hear a difference in a dB. Right now, if Dan Mettler in the back of the room, and Dan's probably saying, I want to turn Frank's volume down by 50 dB. No, if you change my voice by 1 dB, you're not going to hear a difference. Dense audio, you change it by 1 dB. I see the head shaking. The PD can hear that stuff. So just wanted to leave that with you, because it's, you know, some of the things that are going on in our little huddle. So if any Steeler fans are around here, I'll meet you up behind that building. I don't know. Tonight, I'm not, you know. So as you can see, in our world, innovation never sleeps. As I see things going forward, the cloud, you know, if you're probably inundated with hearing about the cloud. So I'm not going to go into that. But that is where the future's going. And, you know, some of the stuff that we're doing, you know, something that's not talked about a lot, but the possibility, there's a lot of possibilities for it, and that's called metadata. Because now we've got enough spots for data that we can be sending along information about how the audio is processed, what the music is, what you might want the receiver to do, that there's no reason that, you know, we shouldn't be doing any of that. So that's part one. Part two is something I've been wanting to do for a while, because a number of years ago, and I think I gave the talk down here at OAB, was was I talked about what I felt were the benefits of transmitting FM stereo using single sideband. And right away, typical, all the wannabes, Ridgey came out and said, you can't do that. You're going to get overshot. You don't know what you're doing. And then a year later, all the competitors had single sideband in their audio processor. So what does that tell you? But what I wanted to do, because we did do some studying about with the we did this at NPR Labs, and it was inconclusive of did single sideband really provide a benefit. And those tests were inconclusive, and it came back around to me a couple years ago because I read some things in some of the trades where somebody made some crazy comments that they did some ad hoc listening where on one Saturday they drove up a coastal highway and said that the audio processor that they had on the air was causing multipath and the coverage only went half as far as it did. And then 1 week later, up a coastal highway on the left coast, we'll leave them nameless, but you guys will be able to figure it out, they put a different product on the air and they claimed they could hear it all the way, you know, like double the coverage. And I'm thinking, that's crazy. Anyone in this room who's been around RF knows that propagation of an FM signal will change. I mean, you cannot replicate the same thing 1 week apart. Okay, the weather's different, the temperature, the inversions, all stuff, let alone a few milliseconds apart. I mean, if you can't have the exact same signal replicated, same coverage, same programming content, everything exactly the same, have multipath parameters exactly the same, your results basically are, well, it reminds me of that team up north in Ann Arbor, okay? Let me put it to you that way. So this had been bothering me quite a bit. So, and also it bothered me that some people were getting some false notoriety because of the fact that they did not apply a single ounce of good engineering practice. And one of the things, and most of the people that are in this room are here because you're doing broadcast engineering, and good engineering practice has been something that's been drilled into us from day one. So I wanted to do my own study on multipath. It's probably the most annoying aspect to FM. It's very difficult to measure in a repeatable fashion. And again, it's due to the FM propagation. And again, you need to know that the signal is, you're going to compare two signals that are exactly the same, one to the other, that the multipath is going to occur at the exact same time on those same signals. And the content has to be exactly the same in sync with all that other stuff. Well, in the NPR lab, we were pretty much able to do that. But NPR Labs is pretty much no more. So and this is an example of the report that they did. It came out about this time of the year, 6 years ago. So I thought, I know what I'll do. I'll get the same equipment. I'll set the whole thing up. I know I can do this. I can do it all in a controlled environment. And I did find the equipment. And John Keane, who was the head of NPR Labs, got me all the audio files and everything. The problem is, and you guys are going to laugh, and it's okay to laugh, to run the HP analyzer on it required a computer that was of MS-DOS vintage. Really. And so I'm, no problem, a DOS window. Forget that. I mean, I could talk to it. I mean, it was one nightmare after another. And I kept going around and around and around of like thinking that this wasn't, you know, I was going down, the wrong alley fast. So I kept digging around. And I think I went over here pretty much the test criteria. And basically, as you'll see here later, when I do multipath testing, I try to test it utilizing what I consider the most difficult composite signal, which is a single channel only, which is equal energy in the left plus right and the left minus right. And then you get the benefit of the dead channel, the quiet channel, to listen to the artifacts. And we can look at it on a scope and all this other stuff. So I'm straining my brain And I figured, what I wanted to do was I wanted to do a test, no multipath, test it with double sideband, single sideband, an alternative processor where they claim, gives you double the coverage, the same alternative processor which employs a multipath limiter to reduce multipath. I wanted an answer, and this was not going to be some ad hoc study driving up a coastal highway because you're a fanboy of some other company. This here is pretty much the NPR Labs RF test bed. This is what I was going to replicate, and actually still sitting on the conference table in my office is most of this equipment. The cleaning lady's ready to kill me because it's been sitting there for months now, but too bad. And then it hit me. While I was having these troubles doing all of this with the hardware setup, I do a lot of work utilizing a program called MATLAB. You may or may not be familiar with it. Just about all our algorithms now emanate out of this. And in one of the recent releases of MATLAB, they had a couple of blocks that do FM modulation, FM demodulation, and they do multipath. So I'm now able, I'm thinking, wait a minute, I can create the perfect test bed because I have a known RF path. Everything timing-wise will be precise down to the sample. I can set various challenging RF paths or profiles in the form of multipath. I can vary it, and then I can demodulate it, and then basically going into this FM modulator is composite. Coming out of this FM demodulator is composite. And then from there, I can run it through a decoder, and I can do some testing. So to give you an example, what we did was we created an MPX file in software. That's an MPX file sampled 192 kilohertz. And then this was done basically utilizing source audio, like left channel only, utilize processor under test. And then here's our MPX file here. This here's the test bed where, I can load in my files. I can switch among them. I've got pictures of spectrum, of scopes, this little FM stereo decoder. Inside it is is basically the MPX decoder that can decode in double sideband or single sideband. We're good on time. I've got audio. I've got a scope. Now I basically have not only the perfect test bed, this is repeatable. Not only is it repeatable, this is shareable. I can take this file. If somebody has MATLAB, I could email it to you. You can set it up and run your own tests. So nothing ad hoc, nothing Goomba, if you will, although it's being done by a Goomba, and we can do it. So what we have here is, I think the next file is, when I click it, this will be white noise, no multipath. So you'll see left, right, up on the top. This is coming out of the demodulator. And then we've got RF and the composite spectrum. I realize we don't have a great set of speakers in here, so some of the things, we'll have. And then the next one is white noise, double sideband with multipath. You can see we're getting some annoyances here on the right channel. And then the next one, I believe, is going to be single sideband. Yep. And you can see how, there's an overlay on the RF channel of basically RF pre-multipath and RF post-multipath. And then you can see how badly we're destroying the composite signal here from the multipath. This is an alternate processor with a multipath limiter. And actually, the multipath limiter is making the effect on the right channel even worse. So much for their multipath limiter. And then now this is music. Same test. This is no multipath. No static at all. a little bit on the right channel is some low-frequency anomalies that are slipping through the decoder. That's just, you know, blame the designer here. Then the next is double sideband with multipath. The next will be with single sideband. And then the next is an alternate processor, double sideband. Then the last one is the same alternate processor utilizing their famous no multipath limiter. You can see on the board in the right channel. And since we're nearing the end here, I'm getting an update. It says please release the information on the known whistleblowers. The two locomotives. Get it? Whistleblowers? All right. I want to close by saying that this is like the preliminary stuff that I've done with regard to the multipath study. To my ears, double sideband, single sideband, I don't know that there's a big difference of reduction. I will say that I was able to disprove a lot of the stuff being said about some alternative methods with signal processing, that it will improve coverage or reduce multipath, when actually what it proved is that on two different Saturdays, somebody was listening where there were two distinctly different signal conditions, which allowed one day to sound better than the other, because from repeatable test results, the other device actually made things a little worse. So I guess last thing is my locomotive recently was found breaking the sound barrier, as you can see here. So I realize I'm running out of time. I guess if there's any questions on anything, on either of the topics, happy to entertain them. If not, thank you much for your time and attention, and enjoy your day here in Columbus. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. I do have a question for you.
It's somewhere around 25 milliseconds end to end.
So that allows for off-air monitoring with air talent, or
you know, I'm going to be honest with you. Is that kind of pushing it? You get over 10 milliseconds,
yeah,
you got problems, and okay. You know, on account of the fact that, I'm not saying everyone's doing it. If you've got HD radio involved, mm-hmm. you're not listening off the air anyhow. And going forward, I will say that, you know, some of the new things we've got coming down the pike, that signal processing related, you know, we're probably looking at processing latencies in that same range as
right.
well.
So that'll push it about 50 milliseconds.
Yeah.
Okay. By the way, Adam Schiff's aide just texted me. Senator Schiff needs to talk to you after the session.
Well, but the only thing, you see, this is Bozzini business. You know, and by the way, those locomotives are in the live steam mafia, so they are protected, you know.
I appreciate it, Frank. Thanks for everybody for attending. The next breakout session in this room.